Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. We're falling. Yeah, I don't know. Some force pushed us over this cliff. And here we are. This is a Let's Play, as I always say, where you get to choose at the end of the video what choices are to be made going forward into the next video, and here we have it with, yeah. 10 minutes climbing. Whatever force compelled you to come this way has lost its grip on you for the moment, but no doubt it is waiting at the top once more. We tried praying to the God of Grace, nothing changed. The rock wall grew no handholds, and our fingers regained none of their failing strength. You're about to open your arms to gather the starlight. Yeah, I tried to cast a spell, hoping to levitate to the surface, or at the very least protect your body with a force field, but of course you cannot let go of the rock to begin the casting. So at the end of the last episode, yeah, those are the choices we had. Climb down or climb back up. Now, almost unanimous, one person voted to climb back up and three or four to climb down. So we're going to climb down. I'm at a loss. So I'm glad I put that to a vote, because I would literally have no idea what to do in this situation, because if we climb back up, then this thing, this force that compelled us is no doubt waiting at the top again. So we're going to climb down, but what would that accomplish? So let's climb down, hopefully get rescued by a rebel birdman faction or something. There's only one way to go. You climb further down the cliff face with no idea where you are going. Okay. Well, we could end up... Are these little, like, streams or something? Alright. Well, maybe we can wind our way back around this way and go in here. You continue to climb until you are almost at the river. You can hear it rushing and splashing over rocks and stones as it hurtles and spreads to the valleys below. What are you doing here? What misstep has led you to this point? What of your quest? Suddenly, without warning, you were wrenched from the rock face by something gripping your shoulders. Grab the rock. It's a birdman. You grab the rock face, but is out of reach already. Whatever has pulled you off has carried you out of reach. You twist your neck around. You twist your neck to look around, but you can see nothing. To all appearances, you are now hovering in midair. A gold-crest eagle? Surely so. And as the panic recedes, you hear the flap of wings. The eagles, then, are here, presumably to aid you, and for the moment, in secret. This one must have come out of hiding to save your life. I remember the one on the plains when we came out. We weren't very happy to see that one. They are friends? Okay. Rescued! I guess they are friends. You are high now. Mampang is far below. Thank you. You call to the bird, but it makes no reply. The eagles cannot speak, only crow, and this one clearly prefers to stay silent. Okay. Flying? The eagle climbs a little, swooping around the walls of Mampang toward an area of many turrets. Okay, he's going to bring me back over the wall. That's nice of him. After a few minutes of flying, the bird begins to swoop down, and eventually it drops you. In a quiet, abandoned corner of the citadel, it does not reveal itself, but flaps away into the air, all but silently. Still, at least you know they are waiting, if only to take you home once your mission is complete. They are waiting. Okay. The eagles are waiting to take us home once the mission is complete. Well, we got that going for us. Wave. You wave to the creature, hoping it escapes to its hiding spot without being detected. Then you look around to see where you have ended up. Okay. The ruined courtyard. We could go back here in the fields again eventually, but I'm afraid that thing... Well, maybe we stay away from the wall. We'll probably end up fighting some things. Eh. I need food. That's what I need. Let me find food somewhere. You are by the base of a stone tower with a curved archway at its base. You look over at the nearby tower. It is squat and ugly, with a low, slightly squalid archway leading inside. Why keep going? What? Why keep going? So I basically stopped here and went in. I want to see if I can get to any of these houses, actually. Before I go in here, I do want to see if I can get some food to rejuvenate. Our stamina is quite low. The broken wall. You follow the path above the water to a high but crumbling wall. This is the way back into Manpang proper. Darkness closes in. You need to rest, especially on an empty stomach. Oh, I don't have that option. Look over the wall. You scramble up onto a block and peer over the wall. Beyond stretches an empty region of lapping water from which tall, isolated, gloomy towers rise. Okay, so now we're looking back from the way we just were. Strange noises reach you from across the wall. Alright, let's just head here and see if I can go back. See if there's anything around here, actually. The path leads back to the hubbub of the city. This is now the dead of night. Let me just go here. Probably nothing to see. Oh, I can go up to here, the side street. You continue along the road. You pass a side street leading off into a maze of smaller streets and alleys. Let's try it. You skulk down a narrow street lined by low warehouses. You catch the scent of grain as you pass one. Can we eat some grain? We got an alley, we got a warehouse, and broken buildings. Yeah, see if we can find some grain or something. You slip into a warehouse. Inside, plenty of empty space, some of it lined with straw. The interior is quiet and dark. You search around in the straw to see if anything has been left behind from the last time this place was stocked, and in one corner you find a serpent ring. What a stroke of luck! Serpent ring. Sounds familiar? Roman numeral 2 giant's teeth? Serpent ring. Ring of green metal? No, we already had that. That's for teleporting. Serpent ring. It's in treasure. Let me just look here. Is this my thing? No, this is not it. I have written down my spells somewhere. Here they are. Serpent ring. Okay, we got, let's see. A pearl ring for invisibility. Yeah, I don't see anything like a serpent ring here. Alright. Sleep here. Removing your pack, you try to settle under your habit despite the uncomfortable floor. You have not yet eaten today, but you have no rations to nourish yourself. Yeah. Remind me again, don't you? You lie back and try to forget your troubles. You're protected here, and your rest is untroubled by dreams. Warehouse. During the past day, you gained considerable gold, plus 20. Search the wheat fields. Enter the monastery of Effie the Fortuitous, disguise yourself as a monk, and found no new clues. The Archmage is still looking for you, which I kind of doubt, because he left to forge war. You pick yourself up and brush away the straw from your cloak. Peek outside. You peek through the doorway. The street outside seems quiet. You head for the door once more. Funny how you have the option to peek. You skulk down a narrow street lined by low warehouses. Yeah, scent of grain, etc. The early morning sun makes the air glow. As you turn a slight corner, you spy three guards walking towards you, one dressed in the finery of a captain. Distracted by conversation, they have yet to spot you. Turn around. You turn, hunching to shield your profile. The whole fortress is on the lookout for you. The conversation of the guards dies as you turn. Odd, one murmurs, then raises his voice. You! Stop there. Your neck prickles as you feel the guard's eyes upon you. You hear the hiss of a blade being drawn and a distinctive cackle. Oh, crackle, sorry. Run for it. Perhaps you have a few moments in which to escape. The warehouse door is just within reach. We're gonna go back in there? You dash into an open warehouse, guards following in hot pursuit. The interior is full of haphazardly piled crates. Oh, I just came from there. You head into the gloom, weaving between the stacks. Hidden, you watch the three guards stop at the threshold, trying to catch sight of you. She still must be in here, one says. They begin to creep along, probing sacks of cloth with drawn blades. Their captain stands at the entrance, feet planted wide. Her skin shimmers in a dim light. There is magic at work. Climb some crates. Slip past the guards? Where am I? I'm hidden? Let me try slipping past the guards. You begin to creep towards the exit. The guards are still very close by, however, so as you scamper down a corridor, you hear one speak up. Footsteps! He shouts. From over there somewhere. The guards begin to converge on your hiding spot. While the captain hangs near the entrance, the two guards get ever closer. As your chest tightens, you hear the clink of one's armor. He is just around the corner! Cause a distraction. You push over a crate stack and it topples with a crash. The guard turns, giving you a window to escape. I should have cast a spell. Head for the exit, I guess. The captain's there, though. You race to the exit, only to find the captain waiting for you, hand resting on her sword. The odd shimmer is still present around her. Let's try a spell. I was pressing L. Control non-intelligent creatures. Well, they are intelligent. Figuratively speaking. Unknown per. Well, this is kind of like... I've got lightning, which would take away almost half my stamina. I don't want to cast an unknown spell. I'm going to do nothing, and then I'll be done for. Turn to stone. Ooh. I could turn her to stone? Or does she have some kind of anti-magic field around her? I can't do that one. Jiggity jig. Cause lively dancing. What do we do? LPZR... Yeah, we'll try it. Turn to stone. I've yet to use this one. You weave the starlight into your design around you, tossing out your handful of stone dust at the captain, but all the powder does is dirty her clothes. She does not even stiffen a little. Why did the spell fail? The captain peers into the gloom, and then smiles as she spots you. There you are, she murmurs. She's impervious to magic, I guess. This seems like a very difficult opponent. I only have 8 stamina. Dancing. Yeah. Pulling the pipe from your pack, you cast a spell, but the captain only whistles along to the tune. Her feet do not move an inch. The captain laughs at your spellcasting. You think I am not prepared? I am a much stronger sorcerer than you. The shimmer around her is an effect you have seen before. Not a force field, though. The captain watches you with something close to amusement. Not a force field. Is this something I can counter? That's the unknown spell. I could always try that. Create stench. Is that... Let's create stench again. N is out. Let me just see what this counters. It counters Zen, which is hovering. Alright, so that's not gonna be it. Yeah, let's try it. Let's try this unknown thing. The purr spell. What? You weave the spell and a bounty of cats appears from somewhere. They scramble all over crates, meowing in a rowdy chorus. Is that the best you can do? Alright, so I've tried how many things? 3 things now. I can't do N. I tried P, J, R. This is going to take too much stamina. L. Counters mag. What's mag again? Protection from magic. That's going to... I'm gonna take away my stamina though. This is gonna counter that. Yeah. They were doomed. Consulting the stars, you bind the magic. The captain staggers back as her magical protection tumbles away, leaving her vulnerable. Your counter was successful. The law mag counter spell has been recorded in your spellbook. The captain finally steps forward, blade in hand. Now the good thing, though, is I have a +6 whatever you call it. +6 cutlass. What if I just charge? 4 down. The captain strides towards you. The captain's smirk never wavers as she cuts through the air. You raise your own sword for a brutal attack and knock her to the floor. She bleeds onto the stone. Nice. Good. Ah, nice. You keep up the pressure. You lunge, aiming at her heart. You catch her underneath her own raised blade. The captain struggles to hide the pain in her face. The captain steps back. Okay, she's stepping back. Can we sideswipe? Good. Oh, she's almost dead. We haven't taken any damage. I love it. You continue your assault. You land a kick at her knee, then cut her as she howls with pain. She thinks better of her own attack and defends instead. While bloodied and exhausted, the captain fights on. The captain shifts away quickly. Dead. Nice. You keep attack? You keep attack. You feint low, then cut her as she staggers. While you cannot catch her off guard, you can overwhelm the captain. Every strike weakens her until she eventually provides you with an opening. You thrust your blade through her neck, and she falls. No stamina loss. Flawless fighting. Well, what about the other two? The remaining guard arrives, only to find you standing over the corpse of the captain. Without a word, he drops his weapon and flees. While he may be looking for reinforcements, you have time to catch your breath. Search the body. Searching her pockets, you find a blimberry potion that will come in handy. You also realize that the uniform is not too badly damaged, and about your size, though if you wear it, you will have to remove the monk's habit and leave it behind. Alright, I'll put it on. Oh wait, I left it! Damn it! I clicked the wrong thing. You leave it in place, content with your monk's habit, I guess. You pick up the guard's sword, a decent long sword, and slip it into your belt. Explore. You poke around the warehouse, finding nothing but scraps of cloth. There's no clerk's office, nor any place for an owner to reside or even work. This must be part of a larger network of warehouses used only for storage. You step out into the alley once more. Alright, so we got a blimberry potion. Gonna hold off, see if I can find anything in these alleys and buildings and such. You pick your way through broken buildings and through the wreckage of fallen homes. It seems the city once housed a lot more people than it does now. Perhaps its life is simply ebbing away. Across the ruins, you can make out the stalls and tents of the bustling market. The air moves a little around you, still icy, but fresh. Alright, well, I've been to the market. They're not selling food there. Let's head back this way. You enter the side street where you encounter the trio of guards. It is rather unremarkable, but a few flecks of blood on the cobbles betray your encounter. Can I go back in here and change the thing? You head for the door. Never mind. Alright, the alley. I was hoping I could still change the uniform. You make your way along the quiet, debris-strewn alleyway. There's nothing here but silence and the faintest smell of death. As the morning moves on, the wind begins to rise. The buildings here are clearly inhabited, used only by Manpeng's lowest strata of society. These are people without hope. Suddenly, a door bursts open next to you. A woman sprints out of it, then slams it closed. Leaning against it, she takes a series of heaving breaths. Look at her. She is dressed in a loose cloth shirt with a bandana tied across her forehead. A notched cutlass hangs from her belt. She looks at you after catching her breath. "Can I help you?" she asks. "Can I help you?" "Seems unlikely," she gasps. "I just emerged from a small disagreement with some goblins. Nothing to worry about, really. The name is Ranny, by the way." "What disagreement?" "The goblins and I were just discussing certain irregularities in their finances." "Goblins don't keep finances." "These ones don't keep them, no," she replies with a grin. "Not a coin. I ran circles around the silly creatures and robbed them blind." "Huh. Why?" "You mean other than for the money?" Her eyes narrow. "Do you actually want to know?" "Yes." "I'm a pirate," she begins. "Or was. Was shipwrecked off the southern coast after tangling with a Pontopedan? My stupid captain decided to hug the coast until he found port, but there would be no bounty in that, so I struck off for Manpeng." "That must have been a dangerous journey." "Yeah, I'm not really sympathetic to goblins. I still feel bad for that one female goblin, though, who apparently had a crush on me somehow." "Oh, it was," she said. "Hiding in caves to avoid the birdman, getting stalked by rat bears. It is one death trap after another, all the way to the coast. And then up the river..." She looks at you sideways. "But perhaps you'd be more interested in my newest venture?" "I'm listening." She leans forward. "I'll tell you what I'm after. I'm going to sneak into the Archmage's vaults and steal his greatest treasure. Enough to let me buy a ship of my own. Or a whole island. You could find a found a convent or something." Oh, she says that because I'm wearing the monk robes. "What treasure?" Despite her hostility, Randy grins. "You simpleton, I'm going to steal the crown of kings, of course." "Madness." "It is not," she growls. "Soon I will have it, and be rich. I'm going to steal the crown," Randy crows, "and that is that. If you have enough to bid for it, then you can make an offer after I've filched it." "And where are the vaults?" you ask, wondering if she has any useful information. "I really just want to know if she knows. Because I've been up there in the tower. That's not the vaults, right?" "Ah, well, that's something I know. But you don't. But they're in the city, sure enough." "The vaults must be protected." Randy giggles, nods, but says nothing more. "You must not take it." "Why is that? I am 1,000 leagues from home, separated from my crew, and stand to gain the wealth of kings." "The crown is dangerous." "So? That does not frighten me. Besides, I will quickly ransom it, and let whoever pays worried about the danger." "But it might destroy the world." "At least I'll be rich," she shrugs. "But enough talk. If you're going to stop me from getting the crown, you better show me your steel." "Oh, brother. Maybe we better take that Blimbray potion." Magical items? Yeah. Back to 8. Let's see what kind of spell we can cast. Really just need some food, damn it. If only it... Like, I ruined like 3 rations. Just, falling in some water, I believe. Crossing some water. Alright, what kind of spell do we have? You open your arms to cast a spell, and the thief cries out in alarm. But just as Randy is advancing on you, the nearby door bursts open. A group of goblins spill out, tripping over each other. There she is! One of them points at Randy. And she has a friend! The goblins charge forward. You will quickly be surrounded. Push Randy into them. You dance behind Randy and kick her toward the goblins. She's left dealing with the bulk of them, cursing you all the while. You are safe from the mob, but one still breaks off to attack you. Alright. Boop. I'd like to start out heavy with that. My +6 cutlass. The goblin races forwards across the yard. You try to gauge his size and swing hard for this creature's head. The goblin gambles menacingly and swings with all its might for your throat, leaving itself exposed. The goblin is weakening. The monster hoists its dagger. You know, I just want to see what sword we picked up. Okay, cool. So we got a long sword +2. That's a new one. We already had this broadsword +1, and we have a cutlass +6. I wonder if we can sell this stuff at the weapon shop. I didn't have a chance to sell the broadsword. He didn't want that, apparently. Maybe the longsword. Alright. Hoisting its dagger. Goodbye. Chasing the goblin, you dart forward and power the edge of your blade into its side. You have defeated the goblin. No stamina loss, flawless fighting. Yay. The goblins are now in disarray. The survivors have retreated, but in the confusion, Randy has disappeared. The wily pirate has slipped away and is determined to steal the crown of kings for herself. You turn to return down the street. All right. We don't have an option to go back that way. I'm not sure where she goes with the vaults, so... I mean, maybe I've been there. I'm thinking as far as vaults... You can't see it now, but... In the back one of these buildings, I believe? Not completely sure where it was. There were stairs down. Yeah. It's on this side somewhere. Alright. I don't know. She most probably is not going to get it. I'm not even sure if it's there, so... You return to the main road. Alright, let's check out these towers. The road leads away towards a ruined portion of the citadel. The sun is hot now. Standing just off the path are two laborers leaning on their shovels next to a pit. I still don't understand, the shorter one is saying. Next to a pit. Look at the trench. You glance over at the trench. It's about 6 feet long and 4 feet wide, and goes down some depth. Listen in. What is there to understand? Her companion replies. We need to dig this trench. The short laborer shakes her head. I know that, but why? What is it for? What is going in the trench? I see, yes. The other laborer says. He scratches his neck. It's a problem. She huffs. All day long, we fix walls and dig holes because Filch tells us to. Filch? Well, who tells Filch? Isn't he from Harry Potter, Filch? Someone is in charge of him. The taller worker sighs. Way of the city, isn't it? Everyone has a place and a task. Stretches all the way to the Archmage. We are digging a trench because he has a plan. The Archmage? She says. Don't tell me you believe in the Archmage. He nods. Of course I do. That's why I'm happy digging this trench and you aren't. I know that the Archmage has a plan for Mampang, keeping us safe from out there. He gestures to the walls. And part of that plan includes this trench. I've never met anyone that's spoken to him, or even seen him, she replies. So, even if he does exist, why should I trust in his plans? The taller laborer looks out at the sky. What else would you do? He asks. She grows quiet. I suppose you're right. Archmage, no, we have a job to do. I could always come by in a few weeks and see what went in here. That would be a start. She then turns back to digging. I just think if this Archmage wants the trench dug so badly, her words are punctuated by the thunk of her shovel, he can come do it himself. The two workers fall silent as they resume their work. Approach them. Why not? You walk over to them and ask what they are discussing. The tall worker waves at his companion. She is simply wondering about her place in the world, why we're digging a trench and so forth. She scowls. I just want to know why. Who ordered it? What's going in it? The Archmage's orders? You ask. Well, obviously. The first laborer replies. The Archmage has a plan for us all, the tall one says, nodding. She rolls her eyes and scoffs at that, if he exists. You do not believe the Archmage is real? She shakes her head, much to the dismay of her companion. Why would I? I have never seen him, nor met anyone who has. It is a tale, like the land beyond the mountains. I mean, he might have been real once, but 1,000 years ago. Long dead now. Then who runs Manpang? The other laborer demands, hissing under his breath now. He might have retreated into his tower, but still, we are doing his bidding. His will keeps the world together. There's more to the world than Manpang. He shrugs. Perhaps. I'm not sure what I believe. The mountains exist, surely, for they block the sun, but what is beyond them? Some guards tell stories of long-dead civilizations rising from sand, or whole cities that float on water. Just as believable as an archmage who whittles away decades in sleep, says his companion. He shrugs again. But at least with him, we can trust our eyes and ears, can we not? We see what needs to be done, even if we don't understand it. All right. I must go, you tell them. The tall man nods. The woman spits into the ground. Patui! Archmage or not, we better dig this trench. There is the money, after all. With that, they bid you farewell and continue digging. All right. All right, I'm done. I'm done with pretty much the entire city, except for, well, everything up to here. And we ended up in one of these towers, didn't we? Or was it this main tower? So, and these. So, next few episodes, I'm guessing, would be exploring this stuff. The road ends in a tall wall of obsidian black bricks, tall enough to keep out a giant, but the wall has crumbled, brought down by the piercing gripweed vines that cover its length. You could scramble over the fallen stones and inside easily enough. The sun has reached its highest point now. The silence beyond the wall contrasts with the bustle of the city. All right, we're climbing over again. You scramble up and over the broken wall onto a narrow strand of stone on the edge of a watery pool. Towers rise on all sides, connected by spidery paths. Sand is scattered over the edge of the pool. Collect up some sand. You scoop up a couple handfuls of usable sand. The path between the towers awaits. We hit the sand. We got the sand. It went back down there. Well, let's see. Two quantities of sand. Okay. It's a magical item. Notice. The towered area on this side of the city is no better preserved than the last. Thin heat beats down from the empty sky. The path splits here, with the shortest way leading up an arched doorway into a nearby tower. Alright, let's check out this one tower. You enter the next tower warily. Once inside, you immediately break out into a smile. This tower might be gloomy, but it's certainly a relief after the ruin outside. Around. Ooh, we gained stamina. I just gained 6 stamina. You have a quick peek around the room, this way and that. It is curiously dark. You pay special attention to the corners, hoping to find something interesting. A colorful spider, maybe? Or some nice juicy moss? You don't see anything, and after a while, start to feel a bit let down. The atmosphere of this place seems genuinely good for you. What a charming place. Wait, we start to feel a bit let down, but then the atmosphere is good? But we're let down. What? I'm wondering if sitting down will give us more stamina, but let's look at the doors. You look over at the doors. There is one behind you and one in front. But when you try to count them, you find you can't quite manage it. It is probably because turning to look at one means the other one is behind, so you can't see it anymore. And you can hardly count something you can't see, after all. Eventually you decide that there are most likely 2 doors here, even if you can't really be certain. This is like the dumb spell, but why is this good to me? Let's sit down and see. You drop down onto all 4s, can we count them, quite merrily. This is no kind of place to sleep, but it's a great place to cross your legs. You try crossing them one way, and then the other, but neither way is really comfortable. You are forced to stand up once more. Clearly there is something wrong with the floor. Look at the floor. You pause where you stand to regard the cracks in the flagstones underfoot. You trace them this way and that. They form loops, branch, and then rejoin. It is, you realize after some time, almost as though all the stones fitted together. After tracing a crack for several minutes, only to have it disappear under your own boot, you look up once more. Yeah, this is like the dumb spell or something. You begin to open your arms to cast a spell and end up falling over backwards and collapsing into giggles. Such a shame there's no one here to enjoy this place with you. It is really quite delightful. Okay. Well, we can't really make a counterspell if I can't cast a spell now, can I? You head for the door but get distracted by the way the view of the world outside moves left and right a little as you sway from side to side. You are soon standing on a spot and just swaying. Let's try to leave one more time before I pray for aid. Why would you leave? This empty chamber is fascinating. You turn around on the spot a few more times to get a full view and fall over. Alright, let's pray for aid. You close your eyes and attempt to offer a prayer, but end up singing a song from your childhood instead. 5 sight masters wearing spiky hats. The song brings a smile to your face and, it must be said, a tear to your eye. You have another try for the far door, though you are by now turned around enough that you can't be really sure which door is which. Stepping out into the open, you feel a slight headache coming on, as though you had drunk too much ale. Alright. Let's go back here so we can try these 2 towers. That was funny. You step back onto the path and walk a short distance. The path splits here, but you must keep moving. The path curves a little as it goes. The sun is beginning to lower and the air begins to cool. Another junction. A low tower to the west is set into the wall of the citadel. Another tower blocks your way north. Which way now? We will do this wall tower here. I would think this would be north. You approach the tower built into the wall of the citadel. There is no door, at least not on this side. You hear a sound like scratching. And cats. You listen more closely. The scratching is mixed with a gentle mewling. Mew back? You meow back, tentatively. Nothing responds. The tower wall appears to be solid stone. You feel across the stone wall, but it seems quite solid. But the mewling is clearly louder, with your ear pressed close. Knock on the wall? You knock on the stone. Nothing happens. Kick the wall? You kick the wall to no effect other than bruising your toe. Let's try a spell. The purr spell? It summoned cats. It still says unknown, even though I used it and found out what it did. Oh, I need to counter cats. Let's hear the future. You sit cross-legged on the ground and put your palms on the orb. You turn the stars into shape around you, and everything changes. You watch in horror as a heavy weapon, spiked and furious-looking beast maid, is struck full in the face, turns on the spot, and falls to a resounding cheer. The vision fades. A heavily weaponed, spiked? I don't know what that sentence is trying to do there. Alright, let's see what else we can do. What's a beast maid? Create explosions. I do not have that pebble. Guess when I had a bunch of pebbles. I cannot heal disease. That's the purr thing. Lightning bolts. Yeah. I know what the counter is for that as well, also. I'm not gonna do that. Counters gum, which is fixed in place or something like that. Web. Talk with animals. Yeah, let's talk to the cats. Pulling out the green wig, you wear it and cast a spell. For a moment, you seem to hear a pleading voice calling, "Join us! Join us! Join us!" Then the voice fades, replaced by just a scratching noise once more. You take off the wig. Oh, move on, no. I clicked the wrong thing again! You leave the tower behind. It's probably purely aesthetic. Let's go back to the path and back to it. Not a place to stand still. You can still hear the sound of scratching from within. I will cast a purr spell. It didn't cause me any stamina when I cast it before. This is Yap, which is, I think, is what we just cast, right? Yeah. Dop. Open locks and doors. Use a stamina. I'm gonna wait on that. You craft the enchantment. The meowing grows louder. Then a portion of the wall seems to tumble away to reveal a room in motion beyond. You step through the opening. Cool. Rooms of cats. Well, I am glad we've got 14 stamina now. We might fight some cats, who knows. You find yourself in a room stuffed full of cat-like creatures. You're almost too distracted to see the wall seal up behind you. The chamber is small, with a low ceiling. It is laid with rugs, beds, and fur. Mews, purring, and hissing come from all over. There must be a few dozen cats in here. Let's look at the outer wall first. See our surroundings. The wall through which you entered has shimmered back into visibility, but you notice that the cats are able to pass in and out quite freely. If you accompany one, you might be able to make it through. A small stream gurgles in the corner, from which the cats gently lap, careful not to dip so much as a toe in the water. Play with them? You spend some time playing with the cats. It's a rather refreshing experience. We got 2 more stamina. Yesh! Pet a cat. I was hoping we'd get more. You bend down and scratch a playful tabby behind the ears. You watch one athletic-looking tabby pounce on a mouse, which turns to smoke as it is caught. Pick up a cat? Oh, it lost some stamina. The cats clearly have an unhappy existence here, so you decide to liberate one and pick up a tabby cat, but on contact, the beast transforms from a delicate, tender friend into a frenetic ball of claws and angry fur. Drop it. You drop it like a hot coal and it dashes off into the pile. Okay, we can pet them. We can't pick them up. Ooh, look at that! You stroke a mackerel-colored black cat near its tail. You feel much better for it. Cats of all sizes and shapes fill the room. They lounge, hunt, scamper, and play. Let's see if we can get up to full stamina. Pet again. You lean down and pet a black cat on the nose. You pat a cheerfully insistent white cat on its belly. Your robe is getting covered in fur. You reach down and tickle a cranky cat along its back. You rub a wiry gray cat behind the ears. You squat down and scratch a white cat near its tail. You stroke a sleek cat on the nose. You bend down and pet a chubby cat on its belly. You pet a playful tabby along its back. You lean down and tickle a tiny cat behind the ears. We're not getting any more. You rub a mackerel-colored black cat near its tail. Okay. What can we do for a spell? We can find a counterspell here. So again, we have purr, which still says unknown, even though we cast the thing twice. I'm trying to choose P again. That's our explosions. We cannot do. Find safe passage. Oh, let's talk to them again. Taking the wig from your pack, you pull it onto your head and form your spell. A sleek black cat sidles up, rubbing against your legs. Hello, he says. My name is Cardamom. How did you get here? We have always been here, he says with a shrug. There is plenty of water, and mice always coming through, so we do not worry. How long have you lived here? Always? At least 4 lives. 4 lives? He chuckles. Do you not have many lives? Do you all get along? Oh, mostly, he says, though we often keep to ourselves. There are exceptions, of course. Such as? Oh, well, you know, I have never had much liking for sesame. He points his nose toward a rather plump tortoiseshell lounging in the corner. Talking about me again? She snaps. I think she likes you. I do not think that, Cardamom replies, and I probably know more about such things amongst us cats. Cardamom flicks one ear. Well, to be honest, he remarks, you seem rather dull. Cardamom winds between you legs and wanders off. The spell wears off as he goes. So I can pet a cat again, no? You reach down and scratch a bony cat on the nose. You stroke a cheerfully insistent white cat on its belly. Oh, try another spell. Maybe, can I, let me try to talk to him again. Maybe I'll talk to another cat this time. We'll do our yapping. Removing the green wig, you put it on and complete the spell. Cardamom looks up at you and yells. Leave me alone, he purrs. Don't you have anything better to do? I don't know when purring sounded like complaining. You squat down and pet an elderly cat along its back. All right, let's try another spell. I'll try purr again. Are we going to add more? More cats? But let's see what else we have. T. That wasn't there before. Create a tower. I can create a tower? What? Alright, let's get back to that. Teleportation, no thanks. And this is, yes, that's lightning, no thanks. Safe passage. Good on that. I'll find my own way, at least so far. See the future. Let's try this again. You sit cross-legged on the ground and put your palms on the orb of crystal. Reaching up to the constellations overhead, you create the spell and everything changes. You see yourself in the room of cats, but your skin is old and wrinkled. Your hair flows around your feet. Your belly is ravenous with hunger, but you do not find yourself needing to eat. Instead, you simply stroke cat after cat, never tiring, simply growing old. The vision fades. Guess how many cats did I pet, right? And what's this again? Heal disease, we can't do. This is DOP, I think. Locks and doors, we don't need to do that. At least not yet. What if we create a tower? Oh. Seriously? You gather the constellations into order around you, and the blonde wig in your hands begins to shiver. A single hair detaches itself, starting to shine and glow before extending and burying itself into the ground. A moment later, the ground beneath your feet has begun soaring upwards, taking you and the cats with it. Unfortunately, the ceiling does not move and is very much in your way. The last sound you hear is the pitiful wailing of 100 injured felines. 100? I thought it said dozens. That's many dozens. So I'm dead? You and several cats have been squashed. Once again, death grasps you in its icy hands, only to lift you impossibly high upwards. Great. What am I doing? Zed spell. The spell finishes in a blinding net of starlight that winds around your body like a sheet. Did I unlearn some of this stuff? Well, I still have the stamina. And the gold. The second time is no more pleasant than the first. The pain builds and then you explode outwards, teeth and skull and limbs flying in all directions. Once more, the explosion dies back as though receding. You look around yourself once more. You have lost another point of maximum stamina. You pat yourself down. You are quite alive. What is more, you have all your possessions and gold and knowledge intact. Okay, knowledge, that's good. So I still know my counter spells. Darkness closes in. You should find a suitable spot to sleep. The alley isn't a bad place to rest. It is quiet, secluded, and offers plenty of shadow. Laying your pack down, you try to settle under your habit despite the cold. You lie back and try to forget your troubles. The long night is kept busy with visions. Mocking laughter seems to ring in your ears. During the past day, you gained considerable stamina plus 12, lost a bit of maximum stamina minus 1, died again, and found no new clues. Keep dying. Note to self, do not create towers within towers. You get quickly to your feet. You have not been discovered, but you should not wait any longer. I'm just going to head right back for where we were. You emerge from the alley into the edge of the main square. An old beggar woman lounges against a well nearby, watching people come and go from the market. A wider road leads west into a run-down area of the city. A few clouds scud across the sky. It's going to be a longer episode. You walk west out of the square, following a wide road. It passes by the monastery gate. As the morning moves on, the wind begins to rise. Before you is a stone facade that stretches the length of the street. Two men in heavy robes sit on the steps. You greet the two men, and one of them grins. "Greetings, sister," one declares. "Feel free to enter, but you will have to excuse us. My companion and I are a little busy betting on the patterns of the crowds." Yeah, let's move away. You nod and walk away. I've been in there already. I'm guessing this is the metal door. Yeah. Time to continue. Should I head for these? You know what? I'm going to head for that. You continue along the road. The sun bakes the flagstones. You pass a side street leading off into a maze of smaller streets and alleys. Let's go in here, because I think we can defeat these things in the fields. Maybe we can pick some crops or something? I don't know. I just want to stay away from that wall, obviously. Yep. Going into the fields. You slip under the archway into a wide field of wheatgrass. Each stalk is taller than you stand. The heavy door slams shut behind you. You move away from the door and into the grasslands. Walking through the long wheat like this will be hard work. The sun has reached its highest point now. As long as we stay away from this. This is just generally into the field, I'm pretty sure. You walk on through the long grass. The blazing sun cannot seem to warm this place. Let's head here. You stride onwards through the field of wheat. Then suddenly you stop. You have seen a prone form lying in the grass up ahead. The figure is a strange creature with long, flat-bladed arms, a little like the curious farmers you saw in the fields of Lower Kare. The figure is fast asleep, an empty wineskin by its side. Long, flat-bladed arms. You shake the creature on the shoulder until it opens its eyes. Instead of yawning, it lets out a series of small chirps. "You're right," it says. "I should probably get back to work." You look over the creature, and it stares back at you. Large teeth bared in what might be a smile. Its eyes are glossy like an insect's, and you see a harsh reflection of yourself in them. "Who are you?" "What an odd question. I'm me." As you speak, the creature idly shaves off some grass with a blade. "Where are you from?"
"Here."
"Do you mean this field?" "My first memory is standing near here, chopping wheat." This conversation is oddly like talking to a plant. "Did you grow?"
"I have always been this size," it says.
"Or you do not remember growing?"
"Maybe. I mostly think about farming."
The creature beams and sits up. "It is so nice to sit with a human. Most avoid the fields, or spit at me and call me a name. Now, what is it?"
"Freak?"
"I have never heard that word before." He shrugs and picks his nose with a blade tip. "I think the Archmage made you."
"Made me?
By Gred! What an honor!"
"You are not troubled by this?"
"Well," its eyes widen, "isn't that the usual way?" The creature bows its head to you. "Not every day I get to spend time with a human," the farmer says. "Few come by here, and most ignore me. Say, perhaps a game of swindle stones? Or drink?"
Let me ask about the spire first. I don't want to play any more swindle stones. A drink sounds nice, though, but...
"The spire in the field. What is it?"
The farmer shakes its head. "It's old.
Older than the fortress. They say they built the fortress to wall the spire in, but I don't know what it's for. Don't go near." You cannot tell if the last words are a statement or advice.
Share a drink. I'm 20 out of 21 now.
The creature offers you a dark purple drink, which it insists is simply water. It smells awful.
"Do I dare take a drink?"
Oh, I gained stamina all the way to max. Which is just one. You take a drink. It tastes like the sewers beneath Kare, but afterwards you feel strangely refreshed. "I am very careful about what I drink," the creature says. "No ale or strange potions. Only pure water for me."
I'm going to move on, because I don't want to play dice.
You elect to keep going. The farming creature nods to you, then scurries away across the grass. Stalks break and crack around you as you walk. The sun is beginning to lower and the air begins to cool.
Alright, let's head to here in the field, then.
You pace on through the wall. You pace on through the tall, swaying stems. Then something large slithers over your foot. Hopping back, you see a large snake disappear into the wheat. You back away from the snake. The stalks close around you. Where did it go?
Head over here.
You move onwards through the long grass. The stalks nearby shiver, and then the snake you saw earlier bursts up. You twist away as it rears up and goes for your neck, and your blade is out before it can disappear again, and you track it with steady paces. But you have fought larger serpents than this one. Let's cast a spell. How long is this episode going to be? This is lightning. Don't want to cast that. I don't think that's really necessary. We're going to end up having the field in flames around us. Can we get back to... Yeah. Cause depression. Make a depressed snake. Clone the caster.
Control non-intelligent creatures. Eh, 3 stamina though. I mean, yeah, we could spare it, but force field. Sharpened blade, which you cannot do. Oh, I hate when that happens. Let's do it. Let's control it. Consulting the stars, you bind the magic. The creature stops in its track, its will now bent to yours. Let's kill it. Maybe we can eat it? Forcing the creature to stay still, you step forward and decapitate it. Dominating the snake as you are, its death feels like losing a limb. Jeez. Somewhere to the north, you make out the shape of a stone spire rising above the walls. Or the stalks, rather. The sun disappears, heading towards the horizon. Let's head here by the wall. You walk on through the field of wheat. You stand in the shadow of the outer wall by the great sealed door. This must be a door to the outer yards, but tugging on it, you find it is firmly locked. I guess it goes here? Or it goes here? But I've been over here. There's no need to go back there. Alright. The wind picks up as the evening draws on. Alright. I think I came from here. Let's go here. You stride onwards through the tall, swaying stems. The grass waves and wafts around your feet. This could be a bucolic, if I'm saying that right, paradise, if it wasn't for the looming ghoul of the sorcerer's spike to the east. You almost trip over a half-rotten tree stump lost in the long grasses. A low murmuring comes from inside the ancient wood. You squat down and peer at the stump. A bee crawls from a crack in the wood and takes off into the air as you watch. I'm not going to mess with this, bees. The sun is sinking. It will be night soon. Not the bees! Not the bees! Clouds rumble as they roll across the dimming sky. Soon it will be dark once more. All right, let's go. Never could get anywhere with that spire. The door is open just wide for you to slide yourself through. All right, let's head back to the cats. The door closes behind you. The sun is almost set and the sky has turned a deep purple. There's no time to waste. Quick! Same descriptions. Another night begins. You need to rest, especially an empty stomach. I don't have the option yet. The moon climbs the sky, filling the world with thin silver light. Strange noises reach you from across the wall. I could collect more sand? Do I still have sand? Wait. Two quantities of sand. Alright. I can get more? You scoop up a couple of handfuls of usable sand. The path between the towers awaits. Oh, I have 4. Okay, cool. And all the sand I can stand. Oh, we're talking about... Yeah, this looks new. You leave the shade of the wall and follow the stepping stones out across the water. Everywhere the signs of ruin abound. Weeds crack the stones. Turret roofs and buttresses have collapsed into heaps. Why has the Archmage allowed such ruin? The moon moves slowly across the dark sky. You cannot help but shiver. You are back amongst the haunted, powerful towers of the inner college. The path splits here, with the shortest way leading up an arched doorway in a nearby tower. Several ways present themselves to you. You can go here. Let's sleep, yeah? Because I guess we have to. Settling down your pack, you try to stretch out despite the wind. You have not yet eaten today, but there's nothing you can do to fill your belly, unfortunately. You get comfortable and rest. What is left of the night is restless with vivid dreams. And all the while, you hear distant laughter from the east. Outside the cornered tower, during the past day, you found new clues. Archmage still waiting, etc. You pick yourself to your feet and try to shake away your more curious dreams. The wind picks up a little spray from the water and splashes it into your face. It stings where it touches you. You lean out over the path and look down into the water. It is black, reflectionless, as though infinitely deep, but you must keep moving. Alright. This is a long episode, guys. I'm waiting for some kind of choice, you know, but there's really nothing. The sun breaks over the horizon. You are back outside the room of cats. There's something about it that makes you want to stay forever. Alright, I'm gonna cast the purr thing. You gather the stars into your design around you. The meowing grows stronger, and a few cats tumble out of the wall, leaving it briefly open to walk through. Yeah, same. Play with the cats, got 21, up to 20. Pet a cat. Alright, let's not make a tower. What other thing was going to try to... That's heal disease. Well, we spun around here. That's our bad tower spell. Safe passage, we could try that. Doesn't that cost stamina? One. I'll probably use that. Oh, I was going to try purr again. Alright, let's try purr. You craft the enchantment. You have the sense of a few more cats spilling out from the pile somewhere, but they may have been there anyway. Alright. This might be something we can't counter. See the future? I think we've tried everything. I don't want to hurl lightning at them. They'll probably kill me, too. Bounce off a wall, you know. Lightning's dangerous. Even the spell. Yeah. Open locks and doors. Create the spell, but the wall of the tower is not a door. Nothing happens. Alright, let's try the how thing. What? You spin the constellations into shape around you, and a familiar calm begins to speak to you. The voice is silent for a moment, then finally declares, "There is no way out of this room." Are you serious? Wait, it says leave. You get up to leave, and a tabby cat jumps onto your arm, pulling you down with surprising force. You find yourself tickling the creature behind the ears. Your robe is getting covered in fur. Once more, you try to push yourself to your feet, but a mackerel-colored black cat rolls over, and you cannot help but start rubbing the feline between the forelegs. There's something very wrong with this room. Once more, you start to leave, and a black cat scrapes at your cloak, pulling you down. You are compelled to begin stroking the creature on the throat. Okay, I petted one. I'm at full stamina. Leave. Once more, you make to get to your feet, but a cranky cat turns on its back, and you find yourself petting the feline behind the ears. How are you going to get away from these creatures? I'm going to have to hit them with lightning and kill them all? It is like the one thing I haven't tried. This is the how. Okay, so H is done. This is, Heal disease, which you cannot do. That's a tower. We've got zap. I think the only thing left is lightning. This is the locks and doors that we just tried. The purr. The yap. Nice cat. I would rather you did not patronize me, he says, although you cannot help but notice he does not move away from you. I apologize. Why, thank you. And I thought all you big types were terribly rude. What can you tell me of Manpang? The cat looks at you with blank eyes but says nothing. Do you know the Archmage? The cat raises its back leg and begins to lick its bottom. Cardamon flicks one ear. Well, to be honest, he remarks, you seem rather dull. And he leaves. All right. I tried. I think all we got left is to hit them with lightning. Which I hate to do. But what else can we do? We can't leave. Except to cast a tower spell and kill myself again. Thereby losing another point of stamina. Oh, okay, we got a choice here. You cast a spell, building up a charge of electrical energy around your palm. Throw the bolt at the wall. You hurl the bolt at the wall, but the force of it simply crackles between the stones and disappears. Let's pet a cat to get some stuff back. No? Alright, never mind. I didn't want to hit the cat. Hit a cat. We have to get out. We have to leave somehow. Need to do it. Well, you don't have the choice for the wall anyway. Anymore. You hurl the bolt at one of the innocent cats and it dies instantly. Fur cinders and smokes as the electricity plays across its tiny corpse. The other cats seem wholly indifferent. Suddenly there's a... Oh god, I lost my god! Suddenly there's a deep and booming voice in your mind, unholy creature. You feel the grace of Korga receding from you, leaving you gasping and weak. I lost 10. I lost all that stamina. I only have 10. The cats are repulsive, vile, scrappy creatures and clearly breeding like rats. You skulk along around the edges of the rooms, trying to stay as far as possible from all of them. Really? With some regrets, you leave the cat room behind, slinking through the wall in the company of a chubby cat. Well, now I can leave. Oh, Korga, I'm sorry. I guess once Korga's grace gone, we saw the cats for what they truly were? I'm not sure. You step back onto the path and follow it a short way. The air moves a little around you, still icy but fresh. Another junction. A low tower to the west is set into the wall of the citadel. Another tower blocks your way north. The air seems to fizz and crackle with secret energy. Which way now? Jeez. This is the longest episode yet, I bet. The path across the water ends outside the next tower, and despite there being a door, you cannot go further. It is surrounded by a curious, shimmering shield. Touch it. You run your hands over the smooth force field. It is definitely magical in nature. It has the subtle give and deep strength of a force field bubble. But how is it so large? And how has it lasted for so long? And who is casting it? Peering through the shimmering force field, you make out some kind of room beyond. There is a table and what appears to be a small pile of yellow sand. This tower is clearly shielded by a spell of some kind. Strike the shield. You draw your cutlass and strike at the shield, only for the blade to bounce carelessly away. It appears the tower is quite impervious to your attacks. Wade into the water. That doesn't sound like a good idea. Do I still have this thing? It didn't bounce out of my grasp, did it? I can't believe we have nobody. Jim. I hope we don't need Korga's help. I suppose we can get back somehow. I still have it. Good. Alright, so we need to counter, force field. Don't we have a counter for that? Can't do that. Yeah. Create a fireball. Easy come, easy go with all this stamina being gained and lost. Counter Zen, just hovering. Oh, I did that. This counters Faf. Requires sand, which we picked up. And Faf is force field. Cast it. You move the starlight into order around you, scattering sand around the base of the tower, but no whirlpool forms. Rather, the force field begins to shimmer, and into steam and smoke, and finally it disappears. The tower is now open for you to explore. A Faf spell, then, successfully countered by your enchantment. Stepping inside. There's now nothing to stop you from going inside the tower. What was it that was being so fiercely protected? Surely be something we do not expect, right? The inside of the tower is Spartan. In the middle sits a table, on which a piece of paper lies. A pile of yellow sand is scattered around the table's feet. The paper is littered with scrawled notes, a few simple star geometries as any acolyte of magic might learn, and the beginnings of a technical discussion of counter magic. The paper continues with sketchy detail, though an interesting conclusion. Counter magic is a fact of the universe, thoroughly proven. There is no magic, no matter how strong, which cannot be countermanded if correctly identified. Even the great artifact itself, once thoroughly understood, can be overcome. Time to move on. That's it? Alright, so might as well head for this North Tower. That's what they're calling it. As the morning moves on, the wind begins to rise. You cross the waters and push your way inside the crumbling tower, without knowing what you might find. The room you find is filled of statues, frozen in various poises. An icy hush fills the air. Is this a gallery of some sort? Slipping between them. You step further into the room. There is no furniture, and from the dust it seems no one has been here in a long while. The statues make the room hard to navigate. They cluster and clutter the floor. You slip this way and that between the statues. The detail on them is extraordinary. Their bodies are exquisitely, prosaically posed. Their faces seem soft enough to stroke. Whoever sculpted them was a rare talent. You browse the statues themselves next. There are old men, young women, children. Their expressions are a mixture of hope, fear, confusion, a whole collection of experience. Some are oddly mundane. One has an outstruck match sticking out from under his shoe that he is in the process of bending down to collect. The eyes of the statues seem to follow you as you move. Of course they do. An unstruck match. You make your way across the room, looking for a way forwards, and there is one, but a statue blocks it neatly. It has been posed as though racing for the door. The statue in the doorway is of a middle-aged woman. One hand is raised in the air, and her face tilts upward as though she was holding up and examining an object that is no longer there. The statue is exquisitely done, including fine details such as eyelashes and a lined face. Someone must have labored long on this. But wait, did one of the statues move? Look above the door. You follow the statue's eyeline to a point above the door. Inscribed there is a symbol, 2. You feel a coldness on your arms. Let's try to counter these statues. I'm afraid shifting the statue might break. It's gonna be... Wait. Alright. It's gonna be something that counters rock. R-O-K. Zob. It's not gonna be lightning. Yeah, it's no other Z. We've got how. See the future. Float in air. Talk with animals. Summon a giant. Does seem like a good idea inside the tower. Oh, cross strength. I don't have that. I do not have fire water. What seems like a good idea? You weave the enchantment. A quiet voice enters your mind. A strange place for a gallery. The voice says, "Do not linger." Its message delivered, the spell fades. I don't know what to do, so... let's see. Alright, so I got Zob. Let me just, like, try to... Alright, so... The Zob spell, I don't remember what that does. That might have been what lifted us up in the air to that... I know we flew up into the air into a tower. But that was what created a tower? I'm not even sure. We can't do strength. Let's try seeing the future, I guess. Alright, you see yourself standing in front of one of the statues. It is a woman, but her face is obscured. The statue reaches outwards, and you watch yourself stretch to take the hand. But as your hand grips hers, the stone turns to putrid, rotting flesh. Your fingers are feeling quite stiff. Yeah, we need to counter... We need to find something to counter... the stone, the rock spell. I already tried that. Float in air. I haven't tried that. Mind you, I don't have unlimited stamina here. No giant. Lightning. All right. Looking for a counterspell. We already know what the counterspell for lightning is. It counters Zen, which is hovering. Which hovering is somehow different from floating. There are no animals here. Alright. So Zob is the unknown spell. Fal. Is float in air. Now apparently it looks like we don't have I don't know. Oh, that's the other. Or So here's my options. Or shift the statue. Now you can't see it on screen at this point, so I'm going to tell you. Now that we have almost an hour and a half for this, we have three options here. Choose from one of the following, guys. Cast the Zob spell, which is that unknown spell that we don't know what it does, or might have cast that in a previous episode, and I don't remember. Cast the Foul, the F-A-L spell, to not to float in air, but to counter the try to counter this. That's what the two spells basically trying to do, is counter this this petrification. Basically, stone to flesh is what we're trying to do, but we don't have it. It's something like that. Or shift the statue. So, we're going to cast Zob. We're going to catch Foul. Float in air. Zob unknown. Or we're going to shift the statue. Let me know what you guys choose. Leave your votes in the comments section below. Thanks so much for watching. Thanks for voting. And enduring. Grow strong. See you next week.